Hello and welcome to the podcast, Laurent Philippon. How are you today?
Hi, Jared. Thanks for having me. Really happy to be here.
It's a pleasure. Where are you? Where are you in the world right now?
I'm in Paris, my hometown.
Yeah. So are you living full time in Paris these days, or do you?
Yeah. I mean, there's still a lot of traveling, and lately a lot of the shoots have been away from Paris. But yeah, Paris is my base. Paris is where I find peace, inspiration. I love it here.
Wonderful. Now, you grew up in France, but I think more in the Alps. Is that right?
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. In the mountains, a bit like Heidi vibe.
Yeah, I find you have an interesting accent as well. I guess this is a little bit different, you know, the accent that comes from the Alps.
Yeah, it is. It's a little bit like Swiss. We're not far from Switzerland.
Yeah. Now, you come from a family of hair. Was your father a barber or a hairdresser?
He was a barber. My father was a barber and for many, many years. Really good barber. He had an amazing clientele. Where we are from is an industrial city, so there's a lot of people, like wealthy people as well, who needed a really great style. And I remember back in the 70s, you know, seeing amazing hairstyle. My dad would do like blow dries and even mullet sometimes.
Super. All on men, or did he work on women's hair as well?
No, it was all on men.
You know, it's interesting to me, as I think, you know, so many great hairdressers from the past 30, 40 years had fathers that were barbers. I know Trevor Sorby, I think Chris John as well. His father was a barber. It's just like, it's an interesting thing that I'm sure there's more than that. Those are the two that come to mind right away. And I think that's kind of an interesting happening there.
Yeah. I mean, for me, it was a little bit of a torture at first when I when I had to go and sweep the floor and, you know, make shampoos for pocket money, because I didn't really like barbering, and I'm still not super into it. I mean, a little bit more lately, actually, but really when I got the virus of hairstyling was really when I started to do hair on women. And when I understood the power that you have, in a way, you know, the power of making a woman beautiful, that's when it really hit me. But at first, I mean, I guess it's also when you're young and you don't really want to project yourself into something that your dad is doing. Maybe that has something to do with that. But it came a little bit later, like when I was 13, 14, and I started to play with my friend's hair, my girlfriend's hair, and that's when it really hit me.
Now, I know that the majority of our listeners are going to be very familiar with you, but I'll do a little bit, you know, for those maybe that aren't. You know, Laurent is, I think, one of the most renowned hairdressers of my generation of hairdressers, you know, those of us who started in the late 80s, early 90s. He's known for this unique combination of classic technique, that real craft of hairdressing, with very innovative, inventive kind of offbeat technique. Intuitive, I think, is the word there. And, you know, it's, for me, it's like whenever you can see a hairdresser's work and know, okay, that's this person or that person, because they have their own mark. Also, along the time there, Laurent was someone who developed a lot of revolutionary hair product, working with Bumble and Bumble in the early days, and I'm sure other brands. But you have this kind of unique, and I want to talk about that a little bit at some point. And, you know, again, still, you know, top of the game there, working constantly on with all the top photographers in the world, top fashion houses. I want to dig into something. I read this interview and doing a little research for this in a magazine called Dirty, which Laurent told me is an Indian publication, which seems really, really cool.
Alternative Indian magazine.
Yeah. And a lot of the questions that I wanted to ask were kind of already there. So it was nice to, you know, and there was something that it started off with that I loved, a quote that they kind of based the whole thing off of, that right away when I saw it, I'm like, I have to understand what this is. So a quote from Laurent was, that he is a hair thinking war machine. So what is a hair thinking war machine?
It's just that I just constantly relate everything I see to hair. I don't know. It could be like a leaf in the nature, or it could be, you know, a car shape or the shape of a bridge, or I don't know, any kind of shape. I just relate it to hair. It's just that it's a passion and an obsession, where it's like constantly thinking about hair. And I mean, I do think about hair on a constant, constant way, but also I love to have a project and have just a few words from, you know, knowing who's the model or what's the project for. And then I also start, you know, thinking about what hair could be great for that shoot. And so, since I shoot quite often, I always think about, you know, what could be good for this or that. Or sometimes I just get an idea and I have a sketchbook where I just kind of like write down all those little ideas that I have there.
You know, I have this kind of theory for myself. I wonder what your thoughts are. It's like, if you've had great training, whatever that means, and we can talk about that, but you know, and that takes time. I think that's one of the challenges these days. You can't become a masterful hairdresser in a year. You know, I don't care who's training you, in my opinion. So, but if you've had great training and great experience and you put the years in, and it's not the technique that's the challenge anymore, it's the actual hair. You know what I mean? It's like, because you know, it's not like we're not doing the same wig day after day after day after day. It's constantly different. And even month to month, even if you're working with the same clients, their hair changes. So it's like the war with the hair. Is that
there is that as well. Absolutely. Yeah. It's not only doing a great hairstyle, but, you know, it's making the girl look the most powerful possible and making her look at her best as well. You know, I mean, I love intricate and amazing technical hairstyle, but over the years became the most important to me to make the girl look like she really owns this hair. And that is definitely a challenge, you know, because kind of like going crazy on a wig or on hair extensions is something very interesting. But, you know, applying it to a human head with a very particular kind of texture or very particular kind of implantation or particular kind of face is another challenge. And it, as you said, you know, it's not only about the technique, but it's really about the eye that you develop over the years.
Yeah, it's interesting to me because it's, I think as hairdressers mature, many of them come to that same conclusion. Like when I was a young hairdresser and many of my peers, it was so much about the technique.
Yeah.
You know, and it was almost like we could only see what was in our hands. And I think some people don't get past that, unfortunately, and they, you know, and they can still be successful that way. But I feel when you kind of mature and it becomes about the suitability and the beauty and not just the technique. And, you know, there's a quote somewhere in one of the things I read where you want people to notice the woman, not the hair.
Absolutely.
Which I think is great advice. Yeah.
Yeah, to me, I mean, we are creating the ideal of a woman when you're on a shoot. And it's the first thing that has to come to your mind is that, wow, she looks absolutely amazing. And then maybe, you know, in the second look, then you can say, wow, she has amazing hair. But that still leaves quite a lot of space for creativity and, you know, creation and new shapes. I mean, hair is billions of filament. It can take so many different shapes. It's fascinating. And that's why also the passion doesn't go down because it's just the challenge is constant.
Yeah. It's never the same. It's not like a route thing that you just do exactly the same, you know, even with hair cutting. I think that's where people run into a mistake. They think, well, I've learned the graduated bob. So, but every time you do it, it has to change.
Absolutely.
It has to.
Adaptation, yeah. in all of this. Definitely.
So I want to delve into a little bit of the concept. As I said, it to me, and I think to most people, you're known for this combination of great technique with an innovative kind of very unique approach as well, combined together. How did you end up there? What in your training led you to have this combination of the two?
Well, I think I can explain it with my schools first, because I had absolutely amazing school. I mean, in the name of Mr. Alexandre, who was the master of French coiffure, and he was not the master for nothing. I mean, he was truly an amazing technician, and also he had an incredible eye. I mean, it was a different era, and it may look a little, dated today, but the technique that he had was absolutely amazing. And I feel very blessed that I got to learn from him. There was a double kind of side to it, because I also kind of got, after working with him for 2.5 years, I was kind of like imprisoned into his vision, and backcombing, making everything look absolutely perfect, and then the wave has to be exactly there, and so when I arrived working with Julien, I didn't get it at first. I was like, this is not what I've learned. What is he doing? He's taking paint, he's taking mud, he's taking metal, and he's, backcombing the hair with sugar. And it took a while before I understood his genius.
Does he have any classic training, or is he kind of more like a self-taught artist? Does he have any of that classic French coiffure?
Well, Julien kind of learned with Daniel Arlot. I don't know if you know him. And no. Jean-Louis David.
Of course.
Jean-Louis David and Daniel. Jean-Louis David was an incredible hairdresser. Mm-hmm. And so was Daniel Arlot. They were maybe the two first ever session stylist in France. Jean-Louis David became an amazing businessman as well, but he
was a photographer as well, right? He kind of captured a lot of his own images.
Maybe.
Told that at some point.
Yeah, that's very possible. But I mean, he was a genius hairdresser, and Julien worked with him. But I think Julien is mostly self-taught. I don't think Jean-Louis David and Daniel Arlot had a lot of influence on him. I think he worked in a salon as well, doing old ladies kind of roller sets. But he was really, a kind of a poet, punk poet, deep inside. And that really reflects on his hair. Was one of the first one to really bring life to hair and not do those like super constructed hairstyle that we could see in the 80s with the asymmetrical or the geometrical thing. He all of a sudden kind of like brought that kind of lived in texture and really kind of brought life to those hairstyle.
As you're speaking, I had a flashback to 1991, I was a hairdresser for 1 or 2 years, and I lived in New York. It's where I was born and raised. And the company Sebastian, the legendary hair company, they did a special event in New York called Dada, Hair Dada, like the art movement.
Yeah.
And they had Bruno Pettini, Orbe, Julien Dees, Robert Labetta.
Wow.
There might have been one. And that was the first time. And I walked away. I mean, now you see all these people, they're incredible. But the one that I remembered as like a whole nother level was Julien. And I had no idea. I didn't really know who any of them were, but I was like just blown away. He had created this, I think it was like a shipwreck theme or something, like the clothes were like, they looked like they had been like at sea for months, and then the hair, and you mentioned like using dirt and things like that. I think he had like clay and dirt, and it was just something completely different.
He made them look incredibly beautiful.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah,
absolutely beautiful. And there's it's funny because there's no really intricate technique with Julien. It's a lot of it just happens like that. You can't. That's why sometimes you feel some hairdresser are maybe inspired by him, but it's absolutely so unique what he does, the texture that he gets. Even by assisting him, I didn't really get it. It's really just so unique, like the way he makes the hair into cloud, that kind of cloudy texture, you know, or the way he paints it. I really don't understand how it happens. It's all in his hands, really.
Right, right. So you have this perfect combination. I mean, the thing that I'm always striving for, and I always, anyone asks me their opinion, it's like this perfect balance of technical and visual, and then you have to somehow put them together and mature.
Absolutely. You know? Yeah, that took a while. That took, you know, many test shooting and then many accidents and bad hair and, you know, having to redo it or like kind of too heavy, or I mean, it took a really long time until I was satisfied. Also, the thing is, with those two amazing masters, the bar was so high that I, you know, I really wanted to be, you know, kind of at least try to reach their level. And so I was really, really hard on myself as well. And, you know, it took a while before I was actually really happy with what I was doing. So, yeah, it was a good school in one way. And then in the other way, it was also really difficult to kind of get out of it and find my
I can relate, because I came from Sassoon. So that was my, you know, and when you mentioned before about Alexandre, that at a certain point you felt like you're in a prison, because it's like, it has to be this way. And well, what if I want to do it a little different? You know, you're in a box. It's a beautiful box and a successful box.
Definitely.
But, you know, I think our generation, we wanted to break the rules a little bit. You know, we had to kind of push out from what had happened before us.
Yeah. I guess that's every generation is a little bit like that. You know, just want to, I mean, you know, erase the people who were there before. I mean, I'm thinking about, I think the young generation doesn't really know who is Alexandre or who is Julien.
Yeah.
I mean, particularly.
Or even who is Vidal. I mean, I'll be honest, they don't, they maybe know that it was like some shampoo that their grandmother used to have, but they don't know the man.
Yeah.
And he's pretty documented, you know, I mean, there's books and movies and everything.
Yeah. But on Instagram, funny enough, there's really not much about Alexandre. And I mean, if someone wants to do a dedicated account to him, I think that would be a great idea, because there's a lot of stuff, like including.
Yeah, do you think they could find enough in the archives, enough content? I'd love to. I mean, I've seen the few images, and but I haven't. I can't say I've seen 100 pictures of hairstyles that Alexandre has done.
I mean, there are a few books where you'll find images, but really, I mean, the owner of Alexandre de Paris, of the brand, should do it.
Yeah, that's good advice. Good advice. So let's get back into your journey. So now we can see like where you, how you got your abilities, you know, this very unique combination of the two mentors that you worked with early. Then did you go right into, you know, graduate from assistant editorial stylist to doing your own work? Did you spend any time in the salon at all?
No, I mean, my time in the salon was at Alexandre and at my apprenticeship in my hometown. But after that, I right away went into session hairstyling. You know, when I joined with Julien, he had just opened an agency in Paris, and they were in need of a lot of people because there was so much demand at the time. And, you know, slowly and organically, I started to do my own shoot through this agency. I was really lucky. And very early on, I met David LaChapelle, who I started to shoot with maybe in 94, something like that, or 95 when I was 24. And so that was also an amazing school to work with David, because he came from LA. He had that kind of, you know, very American way of working. And it was a really, really wonderful way of starting my career on my own with him. I learned a lot with him. And also, I don't know, I guess I was the new hot young hairdresser around. And so I started right away working for French Vogue and British Vogue. Yeah, it was an amazing era. One of the photographers I worked a lot with back then was Michael Thompson, who was very often shooting for French Vogue. And those were pretty big shoots for me as a single hairdresser. I remember not being able to sleep the night before and, you know, thinking, oh my God, but I have to, you know, I have to come up, this is so huge, it's French Vogue, I have to come up with something unique and, you know, putting so much pressure on myself. And yeah, that's, sometimes I still don't sleep the night before the shoot, even 30 years later.
You know, it seems like there was this path for people that had the passion that you had to be editorial or session stylist, or, you know, where, again, you would assist someone, you'd go and volunteer, you'd assist, work these crazy hours, do whatever it took. And then hopefully they would introduce you to an agency, and then maybe you'd make a relationship with some photographers. And then if everything came together, you could kind of go forward. Do you think that still exists, or has the whole thing been kind of turned upside down? Like if there's a young Laurent out there in the French Alps right now, you know, do you think they can follow the same path, or is it completely different?
It's not completely different, because in hairdressing particularly, I think maybe in our business, in fashion business, for photography and maybe styling and makeup, it has changed a little bit. But for hair, young hairdressers do understand that they need to go through assisting. It's still a really good school, and there's no really hair school that is preparing you to a session career. And also, you know, while you assist, you not only you do understand the technique of hairstyling, but you understand the process of a shoot, what it involves in terms of organization, the kind of lifestyle that goes with it, because it's, you know, it's not as easy as it seems. But you're right in a sense that, you know, Instagram has shuffled the codes quite a lot, and it has given opportunity to some, you know, provincial or maybe kind of in the middle of nowhere hairdresser, it has given them a chance of showing their work. So maybe for some cases, I mean, fashion is still kind of a closed world where it's not that easy to get into. But Instagram is a wonderful opportunity for people to show their work nowadays.
Yeah, the interesting thing is that, you know, a true democracy doesn't always lead to brilliant work at the end of the day. You know, it's a challenge where we are, because I think both you and I hopefully would agree that we want everyone to have the same opportunity. But at the same time, the things that you went through is what helped elevate you to this next level, where sometimes this, you know, and obviously I'm someone very vested in Instagram, and I think maybe kind of partly responsible for this happening, but it makes me scratch my head sometimes where it's like, I don't want to lower the quality, you know, just because it's easier to get attention. How do we still make sure that the quality is there? This is an ongoing challenge. That's my hair war.
No, true. I mean, I believe if you deliver quality, it'll also be more perenne, like you'll make a longer, I mean, time will kind of tell, will keep only the best people, you right. know?
Yeah. It's not just 15 minutes of attention. It's a lifetime career. Yeah. Thank you, actually. That's helpful for me, because as I said, I'm scratching my head thinking, you know, is this the right thing? But what you just said has proven true. A lot of times when I see things that get a lot of attention that don't have the same combination of technique and vision that I believe is the heart of the craft, they do. It's just they get a little attention and then they go away, and then something else keeps coming. So that's, thank you. I really appreciate that, actually.
But
let's get back to your story. Enough about me.
Just that said, I do also through Instagram, because you realize that we are a whole world, and I must say that I feel blessed, you know, that I was born in a in a middle class family that was already that was into hair. I was in France, a place where a lot is happening, and it was not that difficult for me to go from my province to Paris. I understand, you know, that yeah, there was opportunities that I caught, but I was already kind of in an environment where it was not. I mean, it is a lot more difficult for somebody who would be maybe in India or, you know, in Tanzania or, you know,
right.
I feel lucky that I was, you know, born here still.
At what point in the journey did you meet Michael Gordon, founder of Bumble and Bumble, and where did that take you? Because I know that's a big part of your story.
Yeah, it is. Michael came to the backstage because Orlando Peter was very much involved with Bumble back in the 90s. And I was assisting Orlando on Jean Paul Gaultier's show, the one where Madonna came out with a stroller, and I think there was a dog in the stroller. That was an amazing show. There was a few chignons, like really Alexandre kind of chignons, that needed to be done. And so I did one on a model, and Michael was there and said, would you like to come and show this technique to New York and show it to the Bumble salon? And I was like, oh yeah, of course. And so
there's that wonderful image on the gallery there where you're kind of putting the pleat in and everybody's, yeah, they're all looking up at you.
Yeah,
is that the actual
shot,
day? Yeah.
You see Michael,
he's got like a little mullet or something in the background, right?
Yeah, it was that time. Yes, I think that's the picture from that first class I gave at Bumble about the French.
Amazing. Bit. So it just started off with him saying, "Come and do a demonstration," and what did he say? Oh, I'll pay you a day rate and fly you in or something.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then how did it grow from there?
Yeah, then it all started from there. Bumble was at a time where it was really developing very fast. It was an incredible laboratory of, you know, not only product, but also style. There was a lot of freedom. There was a team of amazing stylists. Those were absolutely super exciting time where, you know, we could even ask the lab to make so-and-so product, even though without really taking care about the fact that it would be commercial or not. You know, we were just the idea of making an amazing product that was not out there, that was not available. And Michael understood that, you know, asking session hairdresser for ideas for product was the right thing to do, because maybe a little bit more than when you work in a salon, when you work on shoots, you really work with texture and how the light would reflect. And as I was saying earlier, you know, making the model look like she really owns this hair, it needs to look like lived in. And it, you know, you work a lot on the texture when you're a session hairdresser. And so, yeah, it was so great to be able to have that lab at disposition and be able to just make any product that came to your mind.
Yeah, I remember this quote from Michael, I believe it was him, that it was like, you know, it's like being in an F1, Formula One racing. If you could get it to perform when Laurent is doing a shoot or a show, then you know by the time it's like a tire developed for F1 racing. And
yeah.
I, you know, not everyone grasped that, but to me, I was like, oh, I get it, you know? And I can see why it was so important to him and to the development of that brand to invest in that.
Yeah,
and focus
products,
on it.
I remember some products took so long because we really wanted it to be absolutely perfect, but it was something that had never been done before. So it was, even for the lab, it was a challenge to make. And so there was a lot of back and forth, but we never gave up.
I can distinctly remember the kind of the launch and the story behind Sumo Wax, you know, because we had worked with waxes, you know, but it was usually some cheap stuff like Dax. I'm sure you used to use Dax and things like that. And most of us, you know, had that in our kit and knew that it was something, or even Vaseline, if it came down to it, right? But for you guys to actually work and develop something and then bring in that whole Japanese sumo piece. Yeah. Talk a little bit about that for people that, you know, maybe didn't experience it.
Well, I was
the
on a
cauldron of bubbling wax, right?
Yeah. I was on a shoot in Tokyo with a really sweet client who decided to take me to a sumo match, a sumo wrestling match. And it was I kind of had an idea of what the hair looked like, but I had never seen it in real. And I asked the client if it would be possible to meet the hairdresser of the sumo, and he said, let's try. And we were able to meet the hairdresser, actually, and talk a little bit about, you know, what's the technique. And, you know, there's even some very fascinating symbolic in the shape of the hair. And also what is that paste that they're using that looks like it's keeping all the hair together, but yet it's kind of, it's not stiff, like a gel. And so the next day I traveled to the workshop where he was, and he was actually, it's actually one person per generation who has the recipe. It's like all kind of like sacred and holy. Everything that's touching the sumo is kind of like a religion. And so the guy actually showed me the big pot where he was making the sumo wax like that. And I got to take a few back home, back to New York at the time. And we got inspired from that amazing, paste that they were using. Actually, the fact that they were heating it up was also making it very interesting. And so that's
how we used to do that with Dax with the blow dryer, you know, just take the, and then to get really hot on your hands and try to get it in the hair really quick. Yeah.
It's like a bit of cooking in there. Mm-hmm. So we were thinking of a way to heat up. And then we thought, oh, the hairdryer is perfect for that. So we just, you know, you'd have to heat up the jar a little bit to in order to soften the product. That would make it so easy to apply on the hair. And then when it gets cool, then it gets a little stiffer. And then you have a wax that actually has hold.
Yeah. Is that the product you're most proud of developing, or are there other products that you know along the line that you feel really were revolutionary?
The sumo was like really an amazing journey, and then afterwards we did the semi sumo, which was a little bit lighter, a little less hard, and then we did sumo tech as well, which was more kind of like texturizing. It's a great example of what we were able to do back in the days. I mean, not sure many
brands. Are you still thinking about developing product? Are we ever going to see a line, Laurent Philippon?
I don't think I'm going to go there. It's too time consuming, and I just love doing hair. Mm. And I think right now there's not really any product that I think really needs to be done. You know, I think I'm pretty happy. I mean, I still have, new product. Like, for example, I've been loving the Got to Be from Schwarzkopf. Mm-hmm. I think that's a revolution. I mean, it's a really incredible hairspray that allows you to do things that were not possible before, because it just freezes the hair in one shape. It's just amazing.
It seems like it would really work for those architectural styles that you
do. Yeah. No, it's really, it's dangerous too. Huh? You have to be careful with it, because if you put too strong, you can have some bad stories. But no, I have no interest in doing my product right now.
Do you still use Elnet? That seemed like it was always like the editorial hairdresser, every editorial hairdresser. Yes. Yeah, you still, or no, it's not so much?
Yes. Of course. Yeah. Yes. Elnet is just irreplaceable. It's just amazing. You know, it has that shine. It has that hold, that light hold. You can brush the hair, you know, constantly, and it'll always come back to beautiful, shiny hair. So yeah, it's just the most amazing.
That's amazing in a world of product where there's constant development that something like that, I mean, has that changed in, I mean, I've been a hairdresser 33 years. I know it's probably got longer history than that, right?
Yeah, I think it's since the 40s or the 50s. And it's amazing to think that with all the molecules that we have today, we still can't beat it. You know, it still remains. I think it's still the original recipe from back in the day, well, like the 40s or the 50s. And it's still the best hairspray ever.
Do you have a preference of doing fashion shows and runway versus being in the studio or on location and shooting? Does one of them appeal to you more, or do you happy to do both?
I'm happy to do both. I really like everything. What I love about doing shows is that now over the years, we have a core of the team, you know, that we see again every season. And it's a bit like a family. You know, there's really like the heart of the team have been with me for maybe a couple decades, you know, and it's really like family. So it's lovely to be together again and then have newcomers as well, you know, always around the passion of hair. And yeah, it's also a different journey when you style hair for a show. It's not exactly like doing hair for a shoot, because for a shoot there's a lot of tricks that you can, you know, put, you know, it's only 2D, so it's you're never gonna
one dimensional. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So for a show it's 360, so you have to see every angle of the hair, so it's a different mindset in a way, but as interesting challenge as shoots. Yeah,
and it's such a different environment. You know, it's obviously it's not my forte, but it's something I've experienced. I've worked at fashion shows and I've worked on shoots, and the fashion show, it's like so much pressure time wise, you know, and it's like it's this slow build, right, where it's like nothing's happening for very, very long. And then it's like, boom, it's got to happen like right now.
Yeah,
where I think, you know, the shoot, there's a different like tempo to it. In my experience, you know, how do you find the process?
I mean, this, what you're saying about the pressure and the timing and the backstage of a show, that hasn't changed. Yeah. So it's the organization is still sometimes chaotic, and you have to be super quick for doing, you know, sometimes very intricate hair. So, but you know,
and teaching 20 people to do it at the same time.
Yeah,
you know, okay, this is the look.
You know, we need to rehearse the day before to make sure.
Yeah.
Like last season, I did a show where, you know, I kind of did that egg shape, and that was really intricate. So I did a class the day before. You know, it's a bit like we are like a high-level sports team, you know, and so we are all, you know, getting together. We're on the starting blocks, and then they all know how it happens. They all know that, you know, rehearsal could take an hour maybe when it was meant to take 15 minutes, or, you know, there's all like models, you know, got stuck in another job and they're going to come 5 minutes before the actual show. So
with mud in their hair.
Yeah, with mud in their hair. So a lot of the time you have to face situations that you wouldn't face on a shoot. But also, shoots have changed since a bit. Maybe since after COVID, there's a lot more pressure on shoots than they used to be. Like, you need to do more images during the day, and you have just less time than before.
We need more return on investment. Yeah, right? You need 30 finished images instead of 15 or something like that.
Exactly.
What do you think about AI? Is it something that, you know, eventually are they going to just be whipping up these campaigns on AI? Have you thought about it much? Does it worry you?
I don't know. I've seen some images where I thought the hair was beyond. It was just incredible. I hope that this is not our future, though. You know, yeah. I still believe that the human you know, brain and creativity will always be better. And yeah, it's a bit scary. I mean, there's a brand last season that did an entirely AI mm-hmm. campaign with no models and no hair, no photographer, nobody, but it, yet it looked like a campaign that was shot.
Right, right.
So maybe yeah. some brands are going to go for it. I don't know. But I mean, in the end, when you're selling clothes or you're selling hair products or you're selling makeup, it's actually human beings that are going to use it. So there needs yeah. to be a connection.
Yeah, maybe some type of restriction or some type of, you know, clear mark that says that this is not really human, you know, because yeah. it's going to confuse. I mean, just think of the damage that, you know, digital and social has done to teenage girls. Now, imagine now if they don't even need humans. Now yeah. they're going to be comparing themselves to computer generated. You know, that's what scares me. But that's a whole other podcast.
It's a whole other podcast, but it is a bit scary. Like,
so, you know, again, a lot of this has been about the craft and the love of hair. Now, I know about a decade ago, I think it's coming up on 10 years, you published a book, yeah. Hair, Fashion, and Fantasy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell us about that and what are you doing to celebrate the 10-year anniversary?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm so proud of this book. I did put a lot of energy into it. It came out as kind of a idea of, you know, going all the books I could see were like, whether it was like famous hairdressers who were just showing, you know, their career, which is incredible.
Like a retrospective or something.
Yeah, retrospective, very interesting. And I love those kind of books as well. Or it was like, you know, books made by historians that were very scientific and very interesting as well. But I felt like a hairdresser also, you know, has all the legitimacy to lay his eye on the history of hair and kind of make those connection with between fashion aesthetics and the history of hair. Because, you know, when we create an image in fashion, we often refer to the past or to like history or, you know, iconic hairstyles. And so we have all those images in our mind, and I just, and all those references, whether it's history references or from cinema or from history of fashion and photography. So yeah, the wish came from there, really, like to kind of compile all those, kind of like open my cupboard of references, and putting it together in my own kind of vision and logic. So I divided it in eight chapters, which to me kind of like englobed almost like everything, you know. So, and then also including very often some people who would come and give their own idea about hair and the importance it has in the human culture.
I read that in your book is one of the last interviews that Vidal Sassoon did before he passed. He died about 10 years ago, right?
Yes, thanks to Michael Gordon, I got to meet Vidal, and we had an amazing moment together, and it was fantastic to get to talk to this legend. I mean, literally, you know, it was the first time in the history of hair that somebody kind of laid an eye on hair cutting and treating it really like an engineer. And bringing geometric that's according to the bone structure. I mean, that was really a revolution, and it was fascinating to hear it from him.
Oh, and he knew how to deliver it.
Yes.
I'm sure until his last day, if you wanted him to talk about hair, now Laurent. He was very, he always had the hands moving, and
he was amazing, charisma. And so charismatic and amazing to listen to. I actually still have the recording
from
our lunch. We had a lunch together. Yeah, it was really amazing.
Well, you should release that as a podcast. I think people would love to hear that.
Do you think I can?
Sure, I don't know. That I don't know. I'd probably have to talk to his trust, his family. With the book, this is the 10-year anniversary. Are you doing like a re-release or anything along those lines?
Oh, I think I'm just going to do a few posts about it, you know.
A few posts.
And, yeah, I'm going to do a few posts about it. And right now there's a great exhibition in Paris about hair. I invite all the hairdressers who are listening to us to go and see it. I think it's until the end of July. It's kind of unseen before kind of exhibition. It's really very interesting and remarkably curated. And the book is there in the library, and I think it's selling pretty well. So that kind of gave me the idea. Oh, you know, it's in there, and so it's been 10 years. So I just want to do little events, but you know, really happy to talk about it with you, actually.
Well, Laurent, it's been a pleasure to, you know, to talk through these things that I find so interesting. I know that our listeners are going to be thrilled to hear directly from you. The book is called Hair, Fashion, and Fantasy. It is available online very easily. I highly recommend that everyone listening get it and add it to their collection. It's a fascinating kind of display of Laurent's mind and how he relates to our craft. So again, thank you so much for joining me today, Laurent.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you for taking the time to have me. I'm really excited about this.